Okay, reminder, we have exam in here on Friday, and we will use the seating scheme that I described last time, where the first 10 rows, every seat, after the first 10 rows, odd numbered seats, okay? So one is here, and one is here, okay? So please sit in the odd numbered seats if you're sitting further back than the first 10 rows. As I said, the sooner we get started, the more time we have. And this really becomes a factor, especially if there are, you know, there's an exam before us or anything. I guess on Friday there won't be an exam before us, so that'll be good news for that. But still, the sooner you get in and get seated, the sooner we can get started and make sure that you've got a full 50 minutes for the exam. There is a review session tonight at 5 o'clock in ALS 4001. And I sent an email out about that. ALS 4001 tonight at 5 o'clock. I will be videotaping that. Okay? And the last thing was somebody came to me this morning and pointed out that the highlights that I posted for the last lecture made it sound like you were responsible for all of a bunch of stuff in glycolysis. You're not. You're only responsible in glycolysis through the things that I've talked about on Monday. Okay? So that was the first four reactions, basically. Okay? And I've updated the highlights to reflect what I expect you to know of that. Okay, so I've changed the highlights on the last lecture. So if you've already downloaded those, you might want to download them again, and that you'll have the accurate version. Okay, why don't we start with a limerick? In their racing, the two silkworm guys give it all with an old college try. The results in the end did their future portend, since they both ended up in a tie. There's silkworms, folks. Okay. Lame, lame, lame. All right. So last time I finished right here, and I just want to say a couple more words about this reaction, because this reaction is a very interesting reaction in glycolysis. Now, I mentioned that this was the reaction in glycolysis that has a large positive delta G zero prime. A large positive delta G zero prime. Now, a delta G zero prime, of course, determines tendency, but it doesn't determine direction. This reaction has to go forward if we're going to have glycolysis go. So in order for this reaction to go forward, cells have to do some, I don't want to say tricks, but they have to have some considerations for making this reaction be favorable in the forward direction. If we think about the delta G equation that says delta G is equal to delta G zero prime plus RT times natural log of product of a reactant, I just told you that the delta G zero prime is very positive. You know that for this reaction to go forwards, that the delta G must be negative. What does that tell you about the RT natural log term? Must be more negative than the delta G zero prime is positive, right? How does the delta G zero prime become negative? How does the natural log term become negative? My mind isn't working. How does the natural log term become negative? All right, so as we change that ratio of products to reactants to be more less than one, the more negative that term will become. Okay? I'm going to describe today ways in which cells do that. I will describe a way in which cells push the process, and ways in which cells pull the process. Pushing the process means increasing the amount of reactant. That's A. Pulling the process means removing product. That's B. And if you think about that, that means B must get smaller, A must get larger, which means that ratio must get smaller and smaller and smaller, which is going to help the log term to become more and more negative. The cell has a very interesting trick by making that happen. We'll see how that goes. Okay. Well, at this point, we've gone through four reactions of glycolysis. We've gone from one 6-carbon molecule, which is glucose, and we've made two 3-carbon molecules. One is dihydroxyacetone phosphate, and one is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. The cell was working in your interest because in the next reaction they decided you had too many things you had to remember, so the cell converts one into the other. All right? So the dihydroxyacetone phosphate in the next reaction gets converted into glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. This means at this point you have two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So everything from this point forward simply means we have two of them. Okay? The two things are identical. So we have two glyceraldehyde 3-phosphates at this point after having started with glucose. This enzyme is an interesting enzyme. We talked about this enzyme very briefly earlier in the term. When I talked about perfect enzymes, I described enzymes that had very high ratios of kcat over km. And they were perfect because any mutation would make them less efficient. It would reduce that ratio. And I said that there were reasons why cells had perfect enzymes. And this is a perfect enzyme. And the reason that this enzyme is a perfect enzyme is because an intermediate it can form is toxic. So in the route to making the final product, this guy right here is an intermediate in the reaction. If this guy sits around, and no, you don't need to know this structure. I'm just showing you something. All right? So in going from DHAP to glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, this molecule right here is an intermediate. If this intermediate sits around, it will break down and form this guy. Methyl glyoxal is toxic. So the reason that this enzyme is perfect is to, as quickly as possible, convert the intermediate into a product that stops the production of a toxic compound. Okay? So here's a really clear example why having a perfect enzyme makes perfect sense. Okay? Okay. The enzyme is called triose phosphate isomerase. I didn't mention the name, but that's the name, triose phosphate isomerase. And you can abbreviate that TPI if you'd like. Okay. Well, at this point, we've done a simplification. We have everything now identical. We have two molecules of glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. And we're entering what I call stage two of the process. And by the way, some books call glycolysis in three stages, not two. All right. Most books describe the glycolysis as two, and we're going to call it as two stages here. Some put reaction number four in a separate reaction, a separate stage, but that's not a big deal. Okay, so we're entering a phase that's called energy generation because in this phase, we're going to make ATP. The first phase that we just got out of was energy investment because you saw that it cost two different places, one molecule of ATP, meaning that it's cost a total of two ATPs so far. Okay? In the next stage of glycolysis, we're going to produce more ATPs. We're going to produce ATPs, and there'll be more than we've used so far. Let's start with reaction number six. Okay? Reaction number six is the only reaction in glycolysis where an oxidation occurs. It's the only reaction in glycolysis where an oxidation occurs. And you can see the enzyme is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. You can call that G3PDH if you wish. G3PDH. All right. Now let's look at this reaction. This is an interesting reaction. All right. We've got glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate, GAP. We've got an electron carrier, NAD, which is getting converted into NADH. And we have a phosphate. And that phosphate is getting attached onto carbon number one. Now, you should look at this and scratch your heads and say, well, Kevin, when we tried to put a phosphate onto glucose, what did it take? Would the phosphate go on by itself? Took ATP, right? When we tried to put a phosphate onto fructose 6-phosphate to make fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, it took ATP energy again. So what's so bloody magical about this thing here that it doesn't require an ATP to put a phosphate on there? Any thoughts? No thoughts. Justin? Okay, so he's got a good question. Are the concentrations of products and reactants making this reaction much more favorable than we saw before? It's a good guess, but it's not right. And that would, in fact, make it favorable. Yes? Is it because of NAD+? What does that mean? Exactly. What's happening is the oxidation that's occurring is providing the energy necessary for putting the phosphate on. That's worth a point of extra credit. Okay? The energy of oxidation, oxidation releases energy. The energy of oxidation is used to put the phosphate on. So notice the difference here. This is not an aldehyde, folks. This is an ester. Esters happen when you link something to an acid. That means this has gotten oxidized in the process from an aldehyde to an acid. Okay, so that's evidence of that oxidation. And the other evidence of the oxidation, of course, is the fact that electrons have been donated to NAD to make NADH. Okay, well, this molecule right here, 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, or 1,3-BPG, as we will describe it, has a lot of energy. A lot of energy. In fact, this molecule has more energy than ATP itself does. It has more energy than ATP itself does. All right? That turns out to be very fortunate because in the next reaction, this high energy molecule uses energy to transfer a phosphate from itself onto ADP to make ATP. Now, since we have two copies of everything, that means we have two copies of 1,3-BPG, which means we now have two molecules of ATP that we've made if we count starting from glucose. Guess what? We've just evened up the input-output of ATP. We put two in, we're getting two out. We've now broken even. Okay? The enzyme that catalyzes this reaction is known as phosphoglycerate kinase. Okay? And does that name seem weird to anybody? Yeah or no? Why? Kinase phosphorylates. What's wrong with this name? There's nothing wrong with this name, by the way. What's that, what you say? It's actually named for the reverse reaction. Phosphoglycerate kinase is taking phosphate off of ATP and it's going that way. Okay? So remember that reactions can go both ways. It seems weird, but it's not weird. You'll see other examples in metabolism where the enzyme is named for the reverse reaction. And that means that the person who first studied this was studying the reverse reaction. And they said, I've got this enzyme, and it puts phosphate onto 3-phosphoglycerate, so therefore it must be phosphoglycerate kinase. Okay? All right. Now, 1,3-BPG sounds like something you've heard before. Where did you hear something similar before? 2,3-BPG, right? And what was that important for? Hemoglobin. And what did 2,3-BPG do to hemoglobin? Locked it in the T state. Favored the release of oxygen, right? Okay? Well, 1,3-BPG is not 2,3-BPG. Moreover, 1,3-BPG has nothing to do with 2,3-BPG. I've got your hopes all up. It has nothing to do with 2,3-BPG. But we're getting close. Okay? We're getting close. The next reaction, okay, there's actually all three are shown right here. The last three are shown on this step. The next reaction is a very interesting reaction. It's catalyzed by the enzyme phosphoglycerate mutase. It's the first time you've seen that name, mutase. It doesn't mean it causes mutation, by the way. Okay? Mutase enzymes have the name mutase because of an interesting mechanism they use. Okay? In the reaction that phosphoglycerate mutase catalyzes, 3-phosphoglycerate is converted into 2-phosphoglycerate. Okay? And this looks very simple on the surface. Grab this phosphate, put the phosphate up here, you're done. And guess what? That's not what happens. That's not what happens. Okay? Mutases, the mechanism that mutases use is not like that of an isomerase. The isomerase, you saw, there were just simply shifting of positions, and we made a different isomer, and that was it. So they're called isomerases. This looks like an isomerase, but it's not an isomerase. So we have to understand how this enzyme works in order to understand something very important. So I'm going to tell you how this enzyme works. This enzyme works by first putting a phosphate onto carbon number 2. So the first step is a phosphate gets put onto carbon number 2, and the phosphate that's on carbon number 3 remains there. What would be the name of that intermediate? 2,3-BPG. You've just seen how the cell makes 2,3-BPG. Now, this is an intermediate. It's not a product. It's an intermediate in the reaction. But this intermediate is stable. And at a low percentage, the enzyme will release some of those. It slips out. At a low percentage means very little of it escapes, but some of it escapes. That which doesn't escape has the phosphate clipped off of number 3, and you're left with 2-phosphoglycerate. I'll repeat that. The 2,3-BPG that does not escape from the enzyme has the phosphate clipped off of position 3, leaving behind 2-phosphoglycerate. 99% of the 3-phosphoglycerate becomes 2-phosphoglycerate. Maybe 1% gets released as 2,3-BPG. Now, when we thought about 2,3-BPG and we thought about what it was doing, what was it signaling? It was signaling there's a lot of metabolism going on here, right? It's going to take a lot of metabolism to release enough 2,3-BPG to bind to hemoglobin. Normally, only very tiny amounts will be present, but a cell that's metabolizing very rapidly will release more 2,3-BPG, and hello, I need oxygen. That's what the cell is saying. It's a very cool mechanism. Because this enzyme doesn't hold on to its intermediate, the cell is using that as information to tell hemoglobin, I need oxygen. Cells use everything at their disposal. Everything. Okay? It's remarkable to think of that. Everybody understand that mechanism? Pretty cool. Questions on that? Anybody awake? I see a lot of sleepy looking people. I asked somebody before class, how's it going? And they said, it's week 8. You should know. And I just kind of stood back and I said, I'm sorry. Okay. All right, yeah, question. This happens at a low percentage of every time this reaction occurs. So a little bit of 2,3-BPG, okay? If you had, 10 million molecules that are going through. Remember, when we think of reactions as one of these goes to one of these, and in the cell, we've got millions of these going to millions of those. Yes? Okay, is this the cell's only source of 2,3-BPG? Can it be made in other ways, I think is your question. And there are other ways that cells can make 2,3-BPG. This is, for our purposes, the relevant one. Okay? Okay. Okay, so cool mechanism. Well, we're nearing the end of glycolysis. We've got two more reactions, as you can see here. And these two reactions are interesting as well. The first converts 2-phosphoglycerate into phosphoenolpyruvate. Phosphoenolpyruvate has a lot of energy. In fact, phosphoenolpyruvate has more energy than ATP does. Not only does it have more energy than ATP does, it has almost twice as much energy as ATP does. I'll talk about that in just a minute. Before I do that, I want to say something about enolase. Enolase reaction is a very simple reaction. It's a removal of water between the two carbons. The removal of water creates a double bond. That double bond is a very high energy bond. Okay? Very high energy bond. Okay. That high energy bond is responsible for making phosphoenolpyruvate. And by the way, we call phosphoenolpyruvate PEP, which is very easy to remember because PEP means a lot of energy. Okay. The last reaction is catalyzed by the enzyme pyruvate kinase, and I'll say a little bit more about that when I talk about regulation. But this reaction is a really, really interesting reaction. Remember I said phosphoenolpyruvate has enough energy in it to almost make 2 ATPs. In this reaction, we see ADP plus PEP gives ATP and pyruvate. It doesn't make 2 ATPs, but there's almost enough energy there to make 2 ATPs. This reaction is what I like to refer to as the Big Bang. The Big Bang means, boy, there's a lot of energy here. We'll have no difficulty making an ATP. And if you think about it, this is a very inefficient thing for a cell to do, because it's got all this energy, and it doesn't use all of it in making 2 ATPs. It only makes 1 ATP. By the way, there are no reactions in cells that I'm aware of where 2 triphosphates are made at once. Okay? This is one where there would be a chance for that, and it doesn't happen. Okay? Well, wasted energy results in what? Heat. Wasted energy results in heat. That's why your car gets hot. That's why you get hot. And you're getting hot because partly of this wasted energy. The more you're running this reaction, the more energy, the more heat you are releasing. Now, this is not the only reaction. There are many reactions, of course, that waste energy because no reaction is 100% efficient. But the reason that you get hot when you exercise is because of wasted energy. And there's wasted energy occurring right there in the pyruvate kinase reaction. The pyruvate kinase reaction also has a large negative delta G zero prime. A large negative delta G zero prime, that's indicative of the wasted energy. Okay? And pyruvate kinase is one of the 3 enzymes of glycolysis that's regulated. Now, this is really odd and interesting. We talked about regulation, and we talked about feedback inhibition, right? And I made this big point about, well, cells are very efficient. They stop the first enzyme in the pathway so that the whole pathway stops, right? It doesn't make a lot of sense for cells to regulate the last reaction in the pathway, does it? Well, it turns out it does. Okay? And it's because of the special case of glycolysis. Glycolysis, as I've told you, is an interesting and odd pathway when we compare it to other metabolic pathways, particularly with respect to regulation and particularly with respect to energy. Okay? Let me tell you one of the things that affects pyruvate kinase. Okay? Pyruvate kinase is regulated by 2 different mechanisms. It's regulated by covalent modification. It can be phosphorylated. We'll talk about that later. It can also be allosterically regulated. Allosteric regulation, of course, refers to when a small molecule binds to a protein and affects the protein's activity. That means that small molecules can bind to this and affect pyruvate kinase. There's a very interesting molecule that can bind to pyruvate kinase and cause it to be more active. It can literally turn it on when it's in an off state. The interesting molecule that binds to pyruvate kinase is called fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. Where have you ever heard of that molecule before? Earlier in glycolysis, correct? Let's think about this. Let's go back and look at the overview. Here's all of what you've seen in glycolysis. Okay? Where does fructose 1,6-bisphosphate occur? It occurs right there. And what enzyme converts fructose 1,6-bisphosphate into products? It's the enzyme aldolase. And what did the enzyme aldolase do that was interesting compared to the other enzymes? What about the reaction? It had a large delta G zero prime. It was an energetically unfavorable reaction, right? Okay? Well, let's imagine that I have just seen Milam Hall catch on fire. It's my favorite example. And we all decide, oh my God, I've got to get out of Milam Hall. My body starts making adrenaline. And adrenaline, as we'll see later, favors the production of glucose by my liver, which sends it out to my muscle cells. And my muscle cells start seeing glucose concentrations increasing. And they say, oh, well, we're going to need energy, so we're going to convert this glucose into glucose 6-phosphate. We're going to convert this glucose 6-phosphate into fructose 6-phosphate. We're going to convert this fructose 6-phosphate into fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, because all those reactions are favorable. And we get to this reaction, and it's like, boom, we just hit the wall. We just hit the wall, because we've got a reaction that's not very energetically favorable. What happens when we hit a reaction that's not energetically favorable? Well, the first thing that happens is the concentration of the substrate starts to increase. Look what's increasing, folks. Fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. You'll note that is a substrate. That's the A of the B over A. We're pushing the process by increasing the concentration of A. And look what A is doing. A is binding to pyruvate kinase and causing it to turn on. Pyruvate kinase turns on, PEP to pyruvate starts to happen. That means the concentration of PEP will start to decrease. As the concentration of this decreases, this reaction becomes more favorable, and now this one decreases. This one decreases, this one decreases, this one decreases, this one decreases, and now we have started taking away the products. Pretty cool. We have increased the concentration of reactants, and we have decreased the concentration of products so we can get around this reaction that is energetically unfavorable. And the reaction that's energetically unfavorable becomes very favorable, and the cell makes ATP. This is cool, guys. Yeah, question, Garrett. How fast does something like this happen? Once the concentrations establish, instantaneously. Instantaneously. Doesn't take any time at all. It would happen faster than you could put the stuff in the tube. Well, it's kind of hard to do that, but it's happened. You have it faster than you can measure putting in the tube. How about that? Other questions? You guys are awfully quiet. Either you're in awe or you're asleep. I hope you're in awe. Okay, everybody understand pushing and pulling? Makes sense? Okay. Okay, memorize this for the exam. Ha 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 ha. All right. This shows, and what I would urge you to look at here would be, let's look at the delta G zero primes. No, you're not going to memorize these. You should know which ones have the high energy considerations I talked about. Hexokinase, PFK, aldolase, and pyruvate kinase. Okay. This guy right here actually is fairly favorable as well, but I didn't mention that, so I'm not going to hold you responsible for that. Okay. When you look at the delta G, something interesting. The delta G, and by the way, delta Gs are for an average cell, right? We can imagine there's no one delta G because each cell is going to have its own concentrations of each of these intermediates. But if we look at average concentrations, we see that most of these are reasonably close to zero. What does close to zero mean? It means it's easy to go forwards or backwards, and that can be adjusted very readily by changing the concentration of substrates or products. Okay? Question? The ones I said before, hexokinase, aldolase, phosphofructokinase, and pyruvate kinase. Okay? Question? Yeah. Okay, question is, if all these values over here were very negative, would push-pull not work? Well, if it were negative, very negative, you wouldn't need it, right? I'm sorry? Well, the problem, okay, so this question, well, what if it were largely positive, all right? Well, if it's largely positive, then we've got other barriers we have to consider, right? So when we talk about a metabolic pathway, we do have to think about it in broad terms. So that's why I'm focusing on a reaction and how the things on either side of it affect it. Okay? If I said all of these were very positive, I'd say glycolysis is not going to occur, period. So I wouldn't even get to the push-pull. It would never get that far. Make sense? Okay. Okay. Good. Pretty cool stuff. All right. Another interesting consideration about glycolysis, all right? Now, glycolysis had one step of oxidation, correct? That one step of oxidation was the reaction catalyzed by glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate dehydrogenase. That was the one reaction where you saw NAD being converted into NADH. Well, it turns out that NAD in a cell is limiting. The cell does not have an infinite amount of NAD. Therefore, it also doesn't have an infinite amount of NADH. So if I have NAD and I convert it into NADH, it's kind of like having the salt acid thing. I lose one, I make the other, right? If I don't convert NADH back to NAD, what's going to happen to all my NAD? It's all ultimately going to become NADH. And if I have no NAD, what's going to happen to the reaction that requires NAD? Well, of course, it's not going to happen, right? So I have to recycle that NADH back into NAD. How do we recycle it? Well, we recycle it when cells have oxygen, because the electron transport system recycles NADH back into NAD. That means, therefore, that cells need to have oxygen for that recycling to occur. And if cells don't have oxygen, they darn sure better have a backup, or they're going to be in trouble. Okay? Well, it turns out that cells have a backup. And the backup that they have is another mechanism that will convert NADH back to NAD. It's a mechanism that does not require oxygen. And the mechanism is the one you see on the screen. Okay? This is one of the mechanisms. This is the one bacteria and yeast use. What they do, in the case of bacteria and yeast, is they convert NADH back into NAD by converting pyruvate into ethanol. That's the process you know as fermentation. The beauty of that is NAD is produced, and NAD can go back and keep glycolysis going. How many brewers are there in here? Okay, the brewers know that when you're brewing beer or you're making wine, you got to cap it and make sure that there's no oxygen in there, because if you don't, you're going to have vinegar or worse. Okay? The reason you cap it and stop the oxygen is so that this process will happen to make ethanol. Bacteria and yeast use that process. We don't use that process. We'd save a lot on beer if we did. Okay? All right? I'll come back to that in a second. We use this process. So both processes of the regenerating NAD in the absence of oxygen, both processes utilize pyruvate. In our muscle cells, we have an enzyme known as lactate dehydrogenase that will convert pyruvate into lactate. Anybody see anything wrong with the name of this enzyme? It's named for the reverse reaction, right? Okay. But notice what it's doing. It's converting NADH to NAD. It's converting pyruvate into lactate. Some people think that production of lactic acid is what causes muscles to be sore. Some people argue with that. But if you think about it, when you're exercising very heavily, you can be using oxygen faster than your body can deliver it. And when that happens, the only option the muscle has is to start making lactate. Lactate is an acid. And so there may be something to that. Okay? Now, an interesting fact here. All right? I've mentioned it before, but I'll mention it here again. This process is very inefficient because lactate is an end product. It doesn't go to something else. We'll see later how the body deals with it. But it doesn't go to something else. Okay? Pyruvate, if we have oxygen present, will go to the citric acid cycle and get oxidized to CO2, and we'll make a lot of ATP. If we go this pathway that you see on the screen, fermentation, whether it's making ethanol or it's making lactate, if we go this process you see on the screen, we get a heck of a lot less ATP than we get if there's oxygen present. The number I gave in class earlier was the following. If oxygen's present, we get approximately 38 ATPs for every glucose. If oxygen is absent, we get 2 ATPs for every glucose. Big difference. 19 times as much ATP when oxygen is present compared to when oxygen is absent. Now, let's think about those rapidly metabolizing cells we talked about earlier. A rapidly metabolizing cell is going to use up oxygen faster than the body can deliver oxygen. What's going to happen to glycolysis in those cells? Do you suppose it's going to go 19 times as fast? Do you suppose it's going to make 19 times as much 2,3 BPG? Do you suppose that it's going to be much more likely that those cells that really need the oxygen are going to get the oxygen? Absolutely. This is cool. Cool stuff. Okay? You start to understand how your body works because you understand how molecules work. Okay? Pretty cool stuff. I'll tell you another thing about your body that'll surprise you. Okay? Let's review what we've just done, then I'll show you. All right? Pyruvate's got three fates. I showed this earlier, different figure, but same idea. When oxygen is present, aerobic cells will all do the following on the right because this makes the most ATP. The process on the right generates 38 ATPs per glucose. The process here and the process here generates 2 per glucose. Cells want to avoid the 2 on the left if they can, if they want to use as much ATP as possible. I mean, if they want to produce as much ATP as possible, because they're going to produce a lot more ATP over here. Oxygen is very important for a multicellular organism. Okay? The process of pyruvate going to ethanol goes through 2 steps. Oh, by the way, again, you see NADH going to NAD, NADH going to NAD, both fermentation. All right. When we look at what's happening in fermentation, it actually occurs in 2 steps. The first step involves the decarboxylation of pyruvate to make a molecule called acetaldehyde. The second step of the process converts acetaldehyde into ethanol. Okay? That's where the NADH is used, and that's where the NAD is produced. I've got a surprise for you. The surprise for you is we have alcohol dehydrogenase in our body. Why can't we make ethanol? We're lacking this guy. Well, why in the hell do we have an enzyme for something that we don't even have an intermediate with? What the hell? Say what? Okay. We have the enzyme to make acetaldehyde. Why in the heck do we make acetaldehyde? You don't want to make acetaldehyde. If you've ever had a hangover, you know what acetaldehyde is. So why in the blip do we make acetaldehyde? Let's look at the structure of acetaldehyde. What happens? What do you see about the structure of acetaldehyde? What kind of molecule is it? It's an aldehyde. What happens to aldehydes? They're readily oxidized. Doesn't take an enzyme to oxidize acetaldehyde. If we oxidized acetaldehyde, what would it go to? Come on, organic chemists. It would make an acid. It would have the acid part of it. It would be a carboxylic acid. What would be the name of it? Acetic acid. And acetic acid we can burn. So we have this enzyme to detoxify ethanol, which really is a problem in high concentrations. We don't have it to give us a hangover, but the result is in the process of making acetic acid, we're accumulating a molecule that gives us a hangover. Now, before I get the question, which I always get, would be, should I go jogging when I have a hangover? I'll leave that for you guys to figure out. Jogging, of course, is going to affect your ratios of NAD and NADH. And I actually had students at one time that tried this experiment. It didn't end up prettily. Okay. Questions about all that? That's a lot of stuff today, huh? You guys are tired? Should we finish early with a song? Yeah. Oh, yeah. Hell yeah. If I said that 5 minutes into the class, you guys would have said, yeah, right? All right. This is a very popular song. It's to the tune of a few of my favorite things. Aldehyde sugars are always aldoses, and if there's a ketone, we call them ketoses. Some will form structures in circular rings. Saccharides do some incredible things. Onto a glucose, we add a P to it. ATP energy ought to renew it. Quick rearranging creates F6P without requiring input energy. At a high rate, add a phosphate with PFK. F16BP is made up this way, so we can run and play. Da, 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 da. Aldolase breaks it and then it releases DHAP and a few G3 pieces. These both turn into 1,3-BPG, adding electrons onto NAD. Phosphate plus ADP makes ATP. While giving cells what they need, energy, making triphosphates a situation of substrate level phosphorylation. 3-BPG, 2-BPG, lose a water. PEP gets a high energy state just to make pyruvate. So all the glucose gets broken and bent. If there's no oxygen, cells must ferment. Pyruvate, lactate, our cells hit the wall. Some lucky yeast get to make ethanol. This is the end of your glucose's song, unless you goof up and get it all wrong. Break it, don't make it to yield ATP. You'll save your cells from futility. All right.